We started this last week, and if you remember, we took and a look at the Hebrews after they left Egypt and they were on their way to the Promised Land. When they left Egypt, went to the Promised Land the first time, they got there, sent the spies in, we went in, they said, there's no way. 10 of them said, there's no way we can do this. They're giants. We can't possibly hope to overcome them. People got scared. Instead of going in like God instructed them to, they went back out into the desert for another 40 years until all the generation that had doubted the Lord died. And then they came again to Promised Land, and this time they went in and they conquered it. So Lord said he was not pleased about that disbelief, that he wants us to believe him no matter what the odds are. He says he gave them plenty of promises, but the promises were not united by faith in those who heard. Hebrews 4:4. So in Psalm 95, and again in Hebrews 3 and 4, we have a recount of that event to the effect that God gave a very unusual name for the process that they would have of entering and conquering and settling this land. He called it rest. That sounds kind of funny. It doesn't sound like rest, going in and having battle after battle after battle and settling a land. It sounds like a lot of hard work. But in Psalm 95 and Hebrews 4, he calls it rest. Why? Two reasons. One, because there would come a time when the battle would be finished and they would have a time of peace, and then they would be able to rest from their battles. But the main reason he called it is because as they entered in faith, they had every confidence that God was fighting for them. They did not have to go in and worry about whether or not they were going to succeed in their campaign. And so they had, in that sense of the word, rest. And they did not have to try to come up with some kind of strategy on their own or to strengthen themselves on their own, for the strength of God was in them. Now, last week, I read this verse to you from Joshua. This was after they had gone into the Promised Land. And it said in 23, 9 and 10, "For the Lord has driven out great and strong nations from before you, and as for you, no man has stood before you to this day. One of your men puts to flight 1,000, for the Lord your God is he who fights for you, just as he promised you." So I told you last week that we were going to take that phrase, "one of your men puts to flight 1,000, and we're going to investigate that just to see if that was literally true or if that's a poetic embellishment. A lot of people would think, well, that's just an exaggeration. That's just poetry for the fact that God was going to go in and fight for them. However, there are some other things that we might look at in the scripture that might show us otherwise, particularly in 2 Samuel chapter 20, or 23, excuse me. It's talking about some of David's soldiers. And I grant that this was a long time after Joshua's time, but I still think that this is good evidence of what that verse said being literally true. So I'm going to read, I don't have slides of this, I'm just going to read the verses that you have on the screen before you. 2 Samuel 23, beginning with verse 8. Now, what we're going to see in here is that of David's soldiers, there was a group of 30 that were particularly valiant. And of those 30, there was another group of 3 that were extra valiant soldiers. And they were called the 3. You'd have never guessed that, would you? No. Can you? Do you have any guess what the 30 was called? The 30. All right. The 3. Wouldn't that make a great movie? The 3. You know, big action-packed movie. And so, anyway, what we're going to read is some of the things that those guys did. Verse 8. "These are the names of the mighty men whom David had. Joshabasheth," I didn't say that right, but you can read it. "A Tokimonite, chief of the captains, and he was called Adino the Esnite, And that basically means the amazing spear. That was his nickname, the amazing spear. Because of 800 slain by him at one time. And after him was Eleazar, the son of Dodo. Again, I know all the good names are taken. What'd you name your son? Dodo. Oh, how cute. After him was Eleazar, the son of Dodo the Ahohite, one of the three mighty men with David when they defied the Philistines who were gathered there to battle and men of Israel had withdrawn. He arose and struck the Philistines until his hand was weary and clung to the sword. And the Lord brought about a great victory that day. And their people returned after him only to strip the slain. All right, so how many of you have ever swung a hammer all day long? All right, some of you have. Now, if you're used to it, that's one thing, but I'm not used to it. So whenever I swing it all day long, at the end of the day, my fingers start closing. Have you ever had that happen to you? You grip something so hard and for so long that at the end of the day, without your telling to, your fingers just start closing. And that's what happened to this guy. He had been gripping and swinging his sword for so long that they had to, in order for him to drop it, they would have to pull his fingers off of it so that he could let go of it. Now, does that sound mighty? Well, it does to me, because he's swinging this sword against enemy soldiers all day long by himself. Because it says the people returned after him only to strip the slain. Now, after him was Shammah, the son of Agiah-Hararite, and the Philistines were gathered into a troop where there was a plot of ground full of lentils. And the people fled from the Philistines, but he took his stand in the midst of the plot, defended it, and struck the Philistines, and the Lord brought about a great victory. Going down to verse 18. Abishai, the brother of Joab, the son of Zeruiah, was chief of the 30, and he swung his spear against 300 and killed them, and had a name as well as the three. He was most honored of the 30, therefore he became their commander, however he did not attain to the three. So as you can see, this is a very literal passage. It is never intended at all to be something of poetry or embellishment. This was written as fact. There's no reason for us to not believe that if you believe in God. Now, the interesting thing here is that the Jedis had nothing on these guys. You know, Yoda could only dream about such a thing as that. The interesting thing to me is the difference between the Hebrews and the Jedis is that the Hebrews were empowered by a person, not an impersonal force that exists coinciding in the universe and can be used for evil or good. They were empowered by a person who chose deliberately to fill them and to grant them this kind of amazing battle power. So there is one other difference too. The Hebrews were real. I guess that counts for something.
And the power is real.
The power is real. Now, don't get me started on talking about the force. I would do that. But anyway, so, and of course, you probably remember from kids' class that Samson killed 1,000 men with the jawbone of a donkey. That means he was swinging the jawbone of a donkey. Not 1,000 men had jawbones of donkeys. So there's no reason for us to not take that literally. One man puts to flight 1,000. And it is so interesting to me that things that we would see on movies and think impossible was not actually impossible. It really happened. Okay, let's put that to rest. And let's go on in with the meaning of the topic to us. Last week I told you that there were two reasons why a person might stop doing a job. Well, there's more reasons than that, but the two that I'd mentioned are that maybe the job's finished, that it's done, it's completed, there's nothing else to do, so why would you keep working on a job that's already finished? And another reason that's common is if we decide that something is absolutely impossible to us, that throughout our entire life we are never ever going to be able to accomplish this, then that might be at times reason to stop doing the work on it. When it comes to our relationship with God, I believe that many of us are guilty of both of those things, of continuing to try to work on something that's already been completed, even though we can never accomplish it on our own. We are, according to Ephesians, accepted in the Beloved. Now, I'm going to read a lot of scriptures this morning, and those scriptures I hope will end up being the highlight of this message. And after several of them, I'm going to have you say a statement along with me that would be a statement of faith if you truly believe that. But let's just get into the nutshell idea of this concept of our acceptance with God and our position in Him. In a nutshell, God has caused us to be born anew, born from above, John 3, a new creature that did not exist before, 2 Corinthians 5. That person is the real you, Romans 7, if you are truly saved. You have been forgiven, cleansed, made alive, and placed in Christ Jesus. We are righteous before God because the righteousness of Christ was put into us. Therefore, we are completely accepted, loved, and approved by God all of the time. Now, sometimes it might be fairly difficult for us to agree with all that. But all we are doing when we say this is we are saying what God says about us. So where does this extra effort come in? Well, the extra effort comes in when we do things in order to try to make God like us more, or be more open to us, or to accept us more, anything like that. That is, number one, it's an impossible thing. It's something that we could never accomplish in all of our lives. And number two, it's a work that's already been done to perfection. So we should stop trying to do that. Right? Have you ever tried to do some good thing hoping that God would respond by giving you something you wanted? How many of you ever have done that? Okay. Have you ever tried to do some good thing hoping that God would relent in some punishment that you thought you had coming? Have you ever assumed that God was disappointed in you or angry with you? Have you ever tried to work your way back into God's good graces? Have you ever said, God may speak to others, but He doesn't speak to me? Have you ever felt like God only loves you because He has to? In other words, since He said it in the Bible, He has to keep His word, right? But really, He just tolerates you. Have you ever felt like your relationship with God was the Cold War? Now, I do want to stop and make this clear, and I don't know who I might be talking to today, but as I use this word you over and over again this morning, I want to make it clear that in so doing I am speaking to people who've been saved, people who've been born again. If you've not been saved, then the things that I'm saying will not be true of you. But they could be if you chose to come to Christ and place your faith in Him. Otherwise, that's who I'm speaking to when I say the word you. So if you've ever said or believed any of these things, there's a fairly good chance that you are guilty of trying to continue to work on a job that cannot be improved upon, something that you cannot do in your power, something that God has done to perfection. Now, I'm just going to go ahead and tell you, I have done all the above. All of the above. And this has been something that has been I've been wrestling with this idea for years, and I still can't say that I have it clear as a picture. I will tell you this, that some of this stuff is what we're going to be doing in the small groups as we begin to do the Ted Decker study, and hopefully some of this stuff will become clear, but we should not depend on him to be able to make it clear to us, because he's just a man also. He does have some great illustrations by story. I mean, that's what he does best, is tell stories. So I think it's going to be some clarifying to us, but we only are going to find out what this is, means by experience. And the only way we're going to experience it is when we choose to believe it and to keep it in our minds as something that is true of us. And I've believed for a long time that if we could get to the point where we acknowledged what God has done in our lives, and if we truly believed who we are before God, that our outside activities, our earthly life, would begin to come up to match what we know we are inside. And I think that I have many, many scriptures that will bear that out. I think that the Christians, the saved people who have the most problems with besetting sins, are the people who do not understand what Christ has made them to be. And so they are continually trying in the flesh to do something to win brownie points with God. And because of that frustration, and because they never achieve the peace and the feeling that they're hoping to find, addicting sins then come back into their life very easily. So let's just go through some scriptures here and read them, and let's make some faith statements about them. First one is 1 Corinthians 1, 30 and 31. But by his doing, you are in Christ Jesus. By whose doing? God's doing. By his doing, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, so that, just as it is written, let him who boasts boast in the Lord. Now, rather than just trying to give you an explanation of that, let's just make a faith statement based on that verse. All right, let's all say this together. Ready? By his doing, I am in Christ Jesus. And do you believe that? 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. The old things passed away. Behold, new things have come. Let's read this one together. The old me is no more. I am new. Romans 5:1. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. All right, let's read this one. God is at peace with me. Now, you notice that I didn't say I am at peace with God, because I don't really know whether you're at peace with God or not. But in order for me to be able to be at peace with God, I have to know that God is at peace with me. Do you remember, you probably don't remember this, but quite some time back, we did a study in 1 Corinthians, or 2 Corinthians 5, and we talked about the wall of separation that sin erects between us and God. And we know, we've heard this a lot, you know, that with Christ's death, that wall of separation has been torn down. But what we don't often think of is the fact that that wall of separation that sin creates is actually a double wall of separation. Because there's a wall on God's side, and then there's a wall on our side. So as long as we are unbelievers, as long as we are lost in our sinful state, and we have sins that are truly offensive to God, then there is a wall of, I'm not going to use the word hostility, because that's too strong, but there's a wall of separation there that God can't go past, because we're sinners. And then on our side, we know that sin has made us by nature enemies with God. That by nature that we do not trust him, and we do not like to submit to his authority, and we do not like to place ourselves in his hands. By nature is what I'm talking about, by nature. All right? So there's actually two walls. There's God's wall and there's our wall. Now, when Jesus gave his life, God's wall was shattered. And God has never, ever rebuilt it. There is no wall on God's side. However, we need to tear down our wall by putting our faith in him and submitting our will to him. So he has no animosity toward us, but sometimes people have animosity toward him. And if you don't believe that, just watch the news. You're going to find out it's true all over the place. And so that's why I say God is at peace with me. As far as God is concerned, there's no more war. We're united. We are at peace. And in order for me to feel peace, then I have to make peace with him as well. Okay? So God is at peace with me. Colossians 2:13. When you were dead in your transgressions and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he made you alive together with him, having forgiven us all our transgressions, having canceled out the certificate of debt consisting of decrees against us, which was hostile to us. In other words, God broke down his wall. The certificate of debt, which contained all of our crimes and the punishment, has been canceled by Christ. And he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. All right, let's say this one. When I was dead, God made me alive. When I was dead, God made me alive. God did not ask me to become alive and then he would save me. I was still dead when God made me alive. How about this one? God has released me from all my sin. That's what forgiveness means, is release. He has released me from all my sin, not just the punishment, but from the acts and from the nature itself. Romans 8:1. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Let's read this one. I am under no condemnation from God. Do you believe that? I'm under no condemnation from God. All right. So let's kind of summarize what we're saying here, make the point, and then I want to address at least just one of the things that I suspect are coming into your mind that make you question. All right? Is there anything, from what we've seen in the scriptures, is there anything that we can do to raise our level of acceptance with God? Is there anything we can do to make God more open to us? Is there anything we can do to make him like us more? All right. Now here's the thing. If I can't do things to raise my status with God, then I can't do things to lower it either. Why? Because my status with God is not based on anything that I have done. It is based on what Jesus Christ did, his righteousness implanted into my spirit, my life. So if I can't raise my stature with God, then I can't actually lower it either. And this is the place where it really starts to get difficult to understand, because that's not how we're really used to thinking. And so some of you, I mentioned a while ago, have you ever thought that God was disappointed with you or angry with you? And I suspect that the idea of God never being disappointed with us is probably something that's difficult to take. Right? What about that God is never angry with us? Is that difficult to take as well? Maybe not quite as difficult, because the disappointed one, we just are so extremely used to thinking that way. But if we're going to say that God is disappointed with us, the truth of the matter is we're not saying something about ourselves, we're saying something about God whenever we think that way. I know that we look at our lives and we say, you know, I just... there's just no way that I can think that God could not be disappointed with me. In fact, there's no way that I can think that anybody would not be disappointed me, but especially God. I mean, He sees it all. He even knows every thought. And no matter how hard you preach this, I just don't think I can ever, ever agree with that statement that God's never disappointed with me. Well, here's what you're saying. In order for God to be disappointed with us, then that would mean that His expectations or His hopes were not met by us, that we fell short of what He hoped for or for what He expected. So if God expected something to happen that did not happen, what are we saying about God? Yeah, we're saying that He doesn't know the future, or we're saying that He's not in control of the future. All right? So that's what disappointment is. If you expect here, but reality's only here, the natural idea then is to be disappointed. But God always knows what to expect. God knows what you're going to do today and tomorrow and 10 years from now, as well as He knows what you did in the past. And so for God to be disappointed would mean that He had higher hopes for you than what you did. I think one of the reasons why we have a lot of trouble with this is because human parents, they do have higher expectations than what they get a lot of times, right? They have higher hopes than what they get. And, of course, different parents respond quite differently to this. You know, some parents are just kind of hang their head, and another parent's rage, and, you know, and just a variety of different responses across the board. And so, but we know that we've all disappointed our parents at one time or another. And some of those times of disappointment we don't feel bad about because, well, we think they were expecting too much, or that their reality was different than what it should have been, but obviously there's been a lot more times that we just knew we had messed up and disappointed our parents. How many of you would rather your dad or your mom spank you or just come to you and say, "I am so disappointed in you"? Most of us would take the spanking, I think. Yeah, most of us would. But God, being the perfect parent that He is, and being God who not only knows the future and who controls the future, He is not disappointed by expectations that are not met. He knows whether or not we're going to carry out things in our life. He knows whether or not we're going to sin. He knows whether or not we're going to have good or bad motives. And so it would be saying something about God to say, "I think God has disappointed me." That's not saying anything about you. It's saying something about God. That He's not as big as what He really is. That He's not as knowing as what He really is. You know, God knows every single time you're going to fall. And as a matter of fact, God will be in control of that fall. You believe that? I use by an example of that Peter. For on the night before Jesus was crucified, and Peter was saying that he would die for Jesus, and Jesus turned to him and said, "You know what, Peter? Before the rooster crows, you're going to deny me three times." So, did Peter disappoint Jesus when he denied him three times? No, he didn't, because Jesus knew that was going to happen. As a matter of fact, if Jesus knew it was going to happen and it didn't happen, we have a problem there, don't we? A theological problem. And then Jesus also said to Peter, He said, "Satan has asked for permission to sift you as wheat. But when you are converted, strengthen your brothers." So you can see that God was in complete control of Peter's fall. And Jesus knew already what it was going to be, how far it would go, and how he would bring Peter back up out of that fall and what he was going to turn him into. An amazing preacher of the gospel, an amazing apostle that would have an impact on the entire world as time went by. So God's not disappointed in it. So you can just kind of scratch that one off and say, I don't have to worry about that one. God's not disappointed in me. Thank God for Jesus, right? Now, regarding his anger, I think that it's kind of like on the same level as what we've been talking about, except this one might be hard to take in that some of you might be saying, you know, what about discipline? As a matter of fact, let me just do this. I think I'm at the right place. This idea of Christ's work in us, making us complete and perfect and accepted in him, has been a stumbling stone over the centuries, even as far back as Paul's day. And so this is three ways that I see that people stumble over this teaching. One, people see their own sin and just cannot accept the truth of their position in Christ. We're looking at ourselves and say, I don't see how that he could see us as holy and unblameable and unreprovable, even though it says that in Colossians chapter 1. Number two, people are alarmed thinking that teachings they've heard all of their life are being attacked. Like, for example, have you not been told all your life that God disciplines his children? So, does he or does he not? He does. Absolutely he does. Either he does or Hebrews chapter 12 needs to be cut out of the Bible. Yes, God disciplines us. But that does not translate over into saying that God is angry with us. That does not translate over into saying that we have lost some kind of position or status with God. It doesn't make that translation. And again, I come back to the illustration of how we were raised by our earthly parents. And, you know, I don't know how your parents disciplined you, but sometimes parents discipline in anger. As a matter of fact, I would say that just about every parent that's ever lived has at least once in his or her life disciplined children in anger. Now, a lot of people don't even know that that's not the best way. Just take my word for it, it's not. The best way to discipline your children is to keep your anger out of it. You know, if they broke the rules, this is the punishment for the rules. But just keep your anger out of it. The anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. But all of us parents have at one time or another disciplined in anger. And I think that it happens often enough that when we think of God disciplining us, we think of God being angry with us. But it's not that way. He never disciplines in anger. You say, well, what about all those times in the Old Testament that he was angry? And sometimes he was angry with his own people. He was angry with Moses. He was angry with David and all this kind of stuff. Well, this is how I would answer that. The Bible shows God's revelation of himself progressively. In other words, he didn't give all the information right at the very beginning. He gave a little bit, and then a little bit more, and then a little bit more, and then a little bit more, and a little bit more. And one of the big steps in that progression was the institution of the New Covenant. The New Covenant says, no longer will I be angry, but I will write my laws on their hearts. In other words, my people will love to fulfill what I command them. And we know from Romans 8:1 that we read, there's in Christ Jesus there's no condemnation, because Jesus took all of God's anger on the cross. And so the people who lived in the Old Testament, they didn't have all of that information. But now that we who live in the New Covenant, we do have that information. And so therefore we know that everything is taken care of in Christ. In Christ. So even though God disciplines me, I do not believe that he's angry. I do not believe that I have disappointed him. I do not believe that I have lost any status in him whatsoever. All right. I'm just about ready to finish this up. Again, I know there's probably lots and lots of questions, and hopefully between the messages and the study that we're going into, some of those things can be cleared up. But let's just finish with this. Why is this even important? Why is it important that I learn to believe what the Scripture says about me? Why is that significant? Well, I can give you a few reasons right off the bat. Number one, it's very important for your success at overcoming sin. And if you think that this teaching is telling us that sin is not important, then you're mistaken. I didn't mention this, but one of the other significant ways that people stumble over this is by assuming that since God loves us no matter what and we're always accepted, then we can just sin all we want to. And if you take me for saying that, you're taking me wrong. But that's okay, because people thought Paul was saying the same thing. So in order for us to be able to rise above the level that we are on now as far as our success in victory over sin and our ability to minister, it is necessary for us to learn about who we are. Because you will always act like who you believe you are. You will. You'll always act like who you believe you are. And then the other reason, and this is the one that to me is, well, they're all important. But you know what? When I acknowledge and believe who I am in Christ, it makes me happy. And until we get to the point where we see who He's made us to be in His, not only in His image as a human, but made after the likeness of Christ spiritually, that makes me happy. That makes me really, really happy. That's one reason why I like singing "This Is My Destiny," because that song makes me happy. Did it make you happy? A lot of people don't like the word happy. Let's use the word joy, okay? Let's use the word joy instead of happy. You know, I don't put that negative connotation on the word happy that a lot of people do. To me, the way I think of it, they're just pretty much the same thing. I don't mean some kind of a trivial happiness, but I want to be happy. Don't you want to be happy? Yeah. Happiness for me comes knowing that God is at peace with me and that I am at peace with Him. And that's still meaningful to me. After all these years of being a Christian, it's so meaningful to me to be able to look back and say, you know, God is at peace with me. Amen? So I hope that this will become more clear to me and you over the next few weeks, and we can try to answer some of the questions that come up with it. And if you have some questions or things that you don't understand, you're welcome to give me those questions and I'll see what I can do. But as we move forward, and as God continues to cause us to understand, I really truly believe this is necessary for us to be able to truly minister to other people as well. I mean, if we go around saying, you know, all the time, like, you know, I'm just a worm, you know. If you give your life to God, well, He can do the same for you. That's not really where it's at, is it? All right, let's pray. Father, I thank You for allowing us to trust You.